It's such a pleasure to have my next guest here in the studio because this man, what he doesn't know about business isn't worth knowing. I could go through his whole CV, but we'd be here for the whole duration of this interview. Suffice to say now, he leads an organization called WBCSD, which is a collection of CEOs dedicated to sustainability, to the environment, and to net zero. And his name is Peter Bakker. He joins me now. Peter, thank you so much. Let's talk through WBCSD, this collection of CEOs. How did it come about and how did you end up leading it?
So it's about 27 years old. There was the Earth Summit in 1992 in Rio. It was the first time the United Nations brought governments and others together to talk about sustainability. There were 13 business leaders in those days. One business leader got to make a speech in the plenary room and he got booed off the stage after 60 seconds because in those days, everybody thought the business was cause of all evil. So the 13 business people who were there said, we need a voice and organization in this type of meeting. One thing led to the other and WBCSD emerged. I joined about 10 years ago now. I came out of TNT, the transport and logistics group. We in the company had done a lot on sustainability and then a few of the CEOs said, why don't you do this? Because we need now not just a voice and awareness of sustainability, we need to move into action, into solutions, into scale. And they thought I could help.
And are you more or less optimistic now than when you joined?
At the moment, I'm actually quite optimistic, more than I was when I joined. When I joined, there was still a lot of missionary work on why sustainability is important and why companies should care about it. Now it is not about the why or the what it is anymore. It is about how do you decarbonize? How do you become nature positive? How do you explain this to a way to shareholders in a way that they will support it? And that's a modus operandi in which business is at its best. Because business is about, you know, here's a challenge, there's a solution, let's go and implement. And from that point of view, my job is now a lot easier. We need to bring companies together to work collaboratively on solutions, but I don't need to lose a lot of time anymore to explain why a company should be part of this.
Mm. You mentioned shareholders. This is critical because a CEO can do a limited amount without the support of his shareholders. Yep. And often we hear that shareholders say, we get it, the environment, net zero, environment, social governance, fine. Where's my dividend? Why is my share price not going up? That's what they worry about. There's a kind of conflict there sometimes?
Well, I wouldn't call it a conflict. You know, the issue with capital markets in general today is that the risk assessments that they make are pure play financial risks. And what the sustainability agenda brings in, well, there's actually environmental and social risks, which are becoming ever more urgent, which are today disrupting supply chains. And therefore predictability of goods and therefore revenue, that we need to start integrating that into the risk assessment. The minute you have that conversation with a capital market player, an investor or financiers, they'll get it and they can model it into their financial models. So this morning when in the Bühler networking days I was giving the introduction, I was saying, you know, it is important that companies have a purpose. And Bühler is a company that you can hold up as an example of that. But now we need to load the financial system with a similar type of purpose. Because once we can align capitalism with the need to become more sustainable, then we'll accelerate, get scale and speed in the transformation that otherwise, without that change in capitalism, we will never get.
But you've got to have a global buy-in for this to work. In some areas of the world, some countries, are they keener on benevolent capitalism than other places?
Well, you need to be careful in the language that you use. You know, in Europe, you can freely talk about we need to align capitalism, we need to change capitalism. When you go further west, you have to use different words. You talk about the redefinition of value. When it comes to the risks that particularly climate, but also loss of nature, inequality are bringing to the table, people are beginning to align, yeah, these are risks that we need to build in. If I look, you know, in COP26 in Glasgow, one of the biggest announcements by Mark Carney and his crew was G-Vans, bringing together, I think, more than $100 trillion of investors. All the big American funds and firms were in there. And they are now really pulling, how can we give the financial system a purpose that is aligned with attacking climate. And so, yeah, the language you need to be careful of, the expectation of global solutions, like a global price on carbon, are in the current geopolitical world not realistic. So you have to play region by region and find your way in.
Right. And many companies have been caught out doing what's called greenwashing. Sports washing is a very topical thing just now with the World Cup. How do you avoid that kind of lip service?
Well, there's only one real answer to it, and that is you have to have a very, very harsh drive on transparency. So the big push, and that's where part of my optimism comes from, is around ESG disclosures, not the way we have them now, where, you know, every company just discloses whatever suits them best, but a standardized framework that every company uses that is based on material impacts, that if company A and company B make a statement, we can compare these numbers, just as today we can compare revenue or EBITDA, because there's an accounting rule. We need accounting rules for ESG, for non-financial performance. Then we can compare which company is actually doing something versus which company is just having a good talk about it. And then capital markets, investors, financiers can say, okay, these guys are really doing something. Their cost of capital ought to be lower. They will get more funds for their innovation, their solutions, and therefore grow faster. And then we get capitalism to work for sustainability instead of the contradiction that you asked for earlier.
Yeah, yeah. So as a final question, if somebody's watching this who's a CEO who's not a part of WCSD, or somebody who could influence a CEO to become part of it, is the message get on board, or is the message already it's too late, the train has left the station?
No, it's absolutely still time to get on board. The three things we can do for companies is, first, we can help companies decarbonize. How do you decarbonize your company? How do you become nature positive? The second thing is we can lock you into conversations around how do we change your value chain, the food value chain or the mobility value chain. And the third thing is we can really help companies in this journey to the capital market of the future on how do you standardize your ESG, create credible, real stories, real accountability of management teams that want to make the change. And that's where an organization like ours is pretty uniquely positioned.
Wonderful. Peter, thank you so much for sharing that with me today. And if you want more details, go online, look them up, WBCSD. See the work that they're doing, see the CEOs coming together, and give yourself hope.